what's happening in your life. Sometimes we know little bits and pieces of things that people are facing. We know that the students are working really hard and they need all the time for their studies and memorization and exercise and getting into the academies, right? Or we could just not pray that and just, right, just kind of say, everything's peachy. But it's kind of helpful to have prayer support. Amen? Okay, but what about the rest of us? See, we can kind of guess that. But don't you have families? Do you have people back home you miss? Is anything happening in their lives? Does it sometimes distract you? Concern you? See, we don't know the other things, do we? So we can pray generally, and we have some ideas of how to pray for you guys, especially as students at the academy. But and we can do that same thing for one another, right? Well, we can hey, if you're alive in America right now, and you hear the radio, the television, or anything at all, you're either hearing about the Dodgers losing or Trump versus Hillary. Shh, you're in Dodger country, Missy. Yeah, you all pray for those Chicago people like Judy back there. So there's general ways that we can know how to pray for one another. But God wants us to do more than that, doesn't he? God doesn't want us just to say, give lip service to God bless you. And now that's a good thing to say, I believe, isn't it? God bless you. And to really mean it, God bless you. But doesn't it help me to pray that prayer of blessing with more power when I know more about what's happening in your life? The challenge with that is, unless you're a mind reader, it takes us hearing from you. And most of us don't have that mind reading capability. The interesting thing is sometimes God will give you something, right? I've seen that recently where God just impressed a person on my mind and just had the need just to pray. I didn't know what was going on, but God had put that person on my mind and later heard reasons why. And that may happen to you too, but how can we pray for you? See, I think that prayer for another person is an honor and a privilege as well as a responsibility. Will you give us that honor and that privilege to pray for you? By the way, answer to prayer. Okay, answer to prayer. We were praying this last week, and have been praying now for the last few weeks, for a young man to do well on a variety of different tests. We also literally were praying for him to gain weight. Praying for him to gain weight. And now we're celebrating the fact that he gained enough weight, he passed his tests, and he officially, what's the word for it? Not been inducted. That is the word for it. Has been inducted in the United States Marine Corps. Semper Fi, but on your feet, man. On your feet. You're going to be a Marine. You're not going to get the chance to sit, all right? And you're going to be at attention, and you're going to respond. But hey, August 15th, is it? 7th. August 7th. Oh, still too soon. Okay. August 7th is when he actually ships out. And, wow. Calvin, lots of answers to prayer, huh? Yeah, lots of answers to prayer. And what a wonderful thing. I mean, I know the two of you are proud of him because I'm like super proud of him. To have seen what Jesus Christ has done in your life, to have been, for you to allow us to pray for you through that and to kind of walk with you. And guess what, folks? Come August 7th, you better start praying more for him. I'm just saying, boot camp is one of the best times of your life, right? So we need to carry those arms and walk with him through that. And so congratulations and praise God. And thank you for letting us pray for you, Calvin. Yeah. Man, pastor's not supposed to get choked up just over a Marine, right? So how can we pray for you? How can we pray for you? If you don't want to share it, would you at least take the next 30 seconds and talk to God? And if you're willing to share it, would you go ahead and write it on the tear-off? And write it down literally as a prayer to God even as you write. Whatever you do, take these next few moments. Sit still. If you're an old kid and you're hyperactive, just take a few extra breaths. Just relax and talk to God, because He's listening. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. Thank you for the special way that you've blessed Calvin and answered our prayers thus far for him. And Lord, we got more work to do as he prepares to go in and starts his service and all that, Lord. And so help us to continue to be a support for him. Lord, for the students at the academy who, they're already experiencing some of the fun and the rigors that you experience in the military, and the challenges and the stress and the pressure and sometimes the loneliness, but also the importance of team and working with others and helping others. So I pray your blessings upon them and their families. Pray that you'd encourage them, help them to memorize words easier, help them to do the work on the tests well, help them to run hard and to grow in their abilities. And Lord God, we trust that you're leading them to the place and the way that you want them to serve. You've put something in their hearts to be in one of the military academies, Lord. And Lord God, we pray that you would give them the desires of their heart, that you would lead them forward and help them to trust you each step of the way. God, there's others in this congregation are facing challenges, family issues, health issues of family members or even people themselves. There's people that are sick that are and maybe not even here today because of sickness that's been weeks or months going on. We pray for your miracle touch. Jesus, we know that prayer is not about inciting you or convincing you. Really, prayer is about us listening to you. And it's about us trying to seek your will and understand you and allowing you to be a part of our world. Lord, help us to do that. So bless this people today. Answer the prayers in a way that will be very obvious that you're the one at work. And then finally, Lord, we do pray for our nation as we move rapidly towards this election. And like some were even joking recently on TV, it will be wonderful when it's over. Lord, don't let us be so wrapped up in it that we miss seeing you and honoring you and doing your will. I pray for Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump and President Obama, that each one of them would know your love, would understand who you are, would experience your grace, and would listen to you. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like all the kids to come up here right up front. Don't worry, I'm not going to make you do anything. I'm not going to step on your toes, hopefully. I'm not going to bite you. I'm not going to beat you up or anything like that. Okay, I just want to do this. You're getting ready to go to children's worship, right?
Yeah.
Yeah? In the other building, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, will you do me this favor? Mm-hmm. Have fun, okay? Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Have fun and promise me this. Promise me that you'll come back.
Yeah.
You'll come back?
But after your guys are done.
Yeah, after we're done, you come back and make sure that if there's some goodies over there, you get some, okay? But promise me you'll come back, okay? All right, good. Because you see, Jesus promised that he's coming back someday. Jesus is coming back someday. And that's a really, really good thing. He's going to come back for all of us who believe in him. So I just want to make sure that you guys keep coming back too, okay? All right, good. Ow! Yo! See you later. Yep, I knew it. Somebody didn't turn off their phone to silent. Yours too? Oh, Virgil, the two of the leaders in the church. What kind of example are we? Do you believe that Jesus is going to come back? And that everyone who is alive will see him come. Everyone will know it. It'll be very obvious. So, how's he going to do that? We just had some people who were down in Australia. They were upside down, right? I'm sure breathing was more difficult there and everything because the lung has to work the opposite way and all that. So if you're down in Australia and we're up here, how in the world are they going to see when Jesus returns? Don't ask me. I don't know. So I'm waiting for some of you to come up with the answer. Well, I don't know, but the bottom line I know is that the whole world's going to know it. So whether you're down under or up above, or are we under? Or maybe we're all both on the side, right? Well, since the earth is turned on its axis, right? So we're all kind of on the side. Everyone's going to know it. Now let's back up a little bit, try to give us a little bit of reminder about where we're at. We're in Mark 13. And this morning we'll be looking at just that little section, very small section, verses 24 to 27. We'll be looking at where Jesus is talking about some of the cataclysmic things that are going to happen when he comes back. And there's some things that aren't real joyful. In fact, we'll even see that this morning. In fact, we'll see one part where it says that people actually mourn the fact that Jesus is coming back. Think about that one. Why would somebody mourn? Well, that'll come a little bit later. But Jesus... It's Wednesday of what we refer to as Holy Week. Wednesday. Jesus has already been in the temple a couple of times. He's thrown out people out of the temple who were using it for stealing from people and all. And he's watched people give their offerings in the temple. He's left the temple. It's probably early evening, late afternoon on Wednesday. And Jesus is walking out of the temple. And if you have been ever to Israel, or if you saw the pictures I had recently, you notice that when you walk away from the temple grounds, from the Temple Mount, there's these like gigantic stones that have been cut. And you look at all this, and even today, you look at these rocks and like, wow, amazing. If you stand over at the Western Wall, and where the Jews still pray at the Western Wall, it's amazing. You look at all these stones and all, and how high they are. And then you imagine, and what they wouldn't have imagined, they would have seen this huge temple on the top, covered with gold, just incredible. And they're just looking at all this, kind of like, wow, this is just something. And Jesus says, it's pretty special, and it's all going to ruins in a very short time. When and how's that going to happen, Jesus? Well, they continue to walk out, and they head up to the Mount of Olives. By the way, they're on their way to Bethany. Bethany is a little town, a little village, about 4 miles from the heart of Jerusalem. And they're heading up to Bethany. That's where Lazarus, Mary, and Martha live. Remember Lazarus, who he raised from the dead just a couple of weeks ago, before this Wednesday? And so they're going back up to Bethany. And as they're heading back up there, they're going up the Mount of Olives. Mount of Olives, that's the place where he's going to pray all night on the tomorrow night, Thursday night. We're still on Wednesday, and he's heading up the Mount of Olives, and so a couple miles out probably, and he sits down, and they look back over Jerusalem, and he's taking his last view of the city before he dies for it. He's had his last moment in the temple where God has been worshipped, and he's leaving. And a couple of the disciples, 4 of them to be exact, come to Jesus and say, could you kind of explain this a little bit in more detail now for us? And we've been walking through that explanation of what is going to happen. How are they going to know it? How are they going to understand the days and what's happening? And so we come now to Mark 13, verse 24. But in those days, following that distress, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, people will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Jesus already said, the temple's coming down. And it does. 70 AD. An uprising. The Jews have revolted against Caesar. And because of that, in fact, you might remember Titus will actually come and finish this battle. His dad died on the way to actually Jerusalem to fight the battle. And so Titus is now the Caesar. And they come and there's a siege that goes on for quite some time in the city. Thousands upon thousands of people die of starvation in the city. They actually start throwing the bodies just over the wall. It's just a horrible time. The Romans finally break into the city and they destroy it and they burn up things and eventually the whole temple, even though Titus kind of wanted the temple, that gets burned down and completely destroyed and everything is ruins. And in fact, it's never been rebuilt since that day, has it? Jesus said, this is going to happen. And he gives them the warning signals, not only for what's going to happen right before the temple is destroyed, but also the warnings of what's going to happen before he returns. And he'll kind of play back and forth. In fact, if you read Matthew 24, which I urge you to do this, you need to be looking at some of these passages to see more of what I'm telling you. So it's always good to test every pastor, right? And so it's really good to say, well, what does the word say about this? Let's not just take Bill's opinion on this, okay? Let's see what Jesus says. And so Jesus is warning him, says, this is all going to come down. And he's talking about both the ruins there of Jerusalem, but he's also talking about what's going to happen when he comes back. And he begins this text with, but in those days, following that distress. Following what distress? Jesus has just been saying that there is going to be an abomination of desolation. An abomination, Matthew tells us, it's the same one that Daniel talked about in Daniel 9, in Daniel 12, Daniel 11. He says there's going to be an abomination. In fact, there was one of these back in 146 BC. A guy puts a statue up in the temple and he brings pigs into the temple. By the way, that's a bad thing, right? They don't eat bacon in Israel. Right? They don't eat swine in Israel. Why? Because pork pig is bad. It's dirty. And so he brings pigs into the temple and has them sacrificed there, and is doing terribly grotesque things until they finally revolt and throw him out. So they've already experienced this, and Daniel was prophesying that event as well as the end time event. And Jesus just said, there's going to be another time. And this is how you're going to know when the end time has come. Daniel will actually describe that there's going to be a time that's going to be 70 years and 70 weeks. And as we start looking at that, we see that 69 of those weeks take place, which means 69 times 7 weeks, days. Each one stands for a year. And at the end of 490 years, right after Daniel's prophecy, 490 years, guess what happens? Jesus is born. I'm like, that's cool. Aren't you? Daniel prophesies 69 weeks, and right at the end of that time, that prophecy is completed with the birth of Jesus Christ. And then there's this 70th week that we kind of like, it's like hanging out there. And it's the final 7 years of what we refer to as the tribulation when Jesus returns. And Jesus has just said, how are you going to know when that tribulation's starting? It's really going to be simple. The Antichrist, who's already working, the Antichrist, who has already been putting himself in a place of bringing peace and connecting to the worlds and all, to the nations and all, the Antichrist is going to put a statue of himself on the Temple Mount. Ah, but Jesus also says that that actually happens in the middle of the tribulation, 3.5 years in. So what happened before that? Well, before that, there was a covenant with Israel by the Antichrist. And the Antichrist brings peace to Israel and to the world. And the nations all start uniting together with this one world leader. He makes this covenant with Israel, and because of that covenant, they're able to rebuild the temple on the Temple Mount. But at 3.5 year point, right in the middle of it, that's when the Antichrist says he's been shot and killed, by the way, or stabbed or something. He dies, mortal head wound. He dies and he comes back to life. Yo. Dies, comes back to life. And now he has this statue put up of him, and he tells everybody, you got to worship that statue because I'm God. Do you think you would know by then that we're in the tribulation? You think you might just get the idea? And if you're alive then, you might go back and say, oh yeah, Pastor Bill maybe was right about this. Yeah, it's kind of pretty obvious that we're in the end times when that's happening. And then we've got 3.5 years to go till Jesus comes actually back. And that's where we're at this morning. But in those days following that distress, oops. By the way, Daniel said, as in talking about that abomination, chapter 9, verse 27, he will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7. In the middle of the 7, he will put an end to sacrifice and offering. And at the temple, he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him. 1 7, 7 years, middle 3.5 years. Daniel 11:31. His armed forces will rise up to desecrate the temple fortress and will abolish the daily sacrifice, a sacrifice that he had given them permission to do at the beginning of the tribulation. Then they will set up the abomination that causes desolation. Daniel 12:11. From the time the daily sacrifice is abolished and the abomination that causes desolation is set up, there will be 1290 days. They had a calendar that was 360 days long. 1290 days. Somebody do the math. 3.5 years. Alan Carr says the days described by Jesus will begin at a specific time. Verse 14 talks about the abomination of desolation. This is a reference to the Antichrist, the future demon-possessed world ruler. He will make a 7-year peace treaty with the nation of Israel. They will rebuild their temple in Jerusalem and will once again worship God by keeping the sacrifices mandated in the law of Moses. Halfway through that 7-year period, the Antichrist will break his treaty with Israel. He will enter the Holy of Holies in their temple, and he will declare that he is God, and he will demand to be worshipped. And if you do not worship, he says you will die. Jesus goes on, he says, but in those days following that distress, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. The sun and the stars will be darkened. How is that possible? Revelation 6, verse 12, I watched as he opened the sixth seal. There was a great earthquake. The sun turned black like sackcloth made of goat hair. The whole moon turned blood red, and the stars in the sky fell to earth. As figs drop from a fig tree when shaken by a strong wind, the heavens receded like a scroll being rolled up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. Have you ever researched what would happen if some other body, heavenly body, came close to the earth? Have you researched what would happen if it just shook us one part of a degree? It's horrible what could take place. The earthquakes, the water on the ocean would suddenly be where the land was, and where the land was would be now ocean, and everything would change on the globe if you just twisted this just a little. That's why it's so amazing that we're alive, folks. It's so amazing that there's life existent on this tiny little dot in the midst of an immense universe, that on this tiny little dot that there's life, and that if this dot just twists, you can't even see the amount of 1 degree. If it just twisted, life wouldn't be here. Life would be all destroyed, all turned up upside down. If we were just a little bit closer, we'd be fried. If we were a little farther away from the sun, we'd be frozen to death. I mean, it's the miracle of life being present on this planet, just unbelievable. Isaiah 13 says, see, the day of the Lord is coming, a cruel day with wrath and fierce anger, to make the land desolate and destroy the sinners within it. The stars of heaven and their constellations will not show their light. The rising sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. I will punish the world for its evil, the wicked for their sins. I will put an end to the arrogance of the haughty and will humble the pride of the ruthless. Therefore, I will make the heavens tremble and the earth will shake from its place at the wrath of the Lord Almighty in the day of its burning anger. Have you been down in the valley when we've had a fire in the mountains? Well, have you been in the mountains when you saw smoke coming right across you and literally cover up the sun? Okay, that's just a little tiny, 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 tiny part of the world. But if fires and earthquakes and stuff like this were going on all across the globe, imagine that, how the sun would be covered by the dark. And of course, if the sun's not shining, is the moon shining? No, the moon doesn't shine. The moon reflects. But if the moon can't see the sun, I guess the moon doesn't see, but nevertheless, if the moon can't be in the line of sight from the sun, and so the sunlight's not shining on the moon would be dark at night too. Everything's dark. Ezekiel 32, when I snuff you out, oh, thank you. I will cover the heavens and darken their stars. I will cover the sun with a cloud, and the moon will not give its light. All the shining lights in the heavens I will darken over you. I will bring darkness over your land, declares the sovereign Lord. I will trouble the hearts of many peoples when I bring about your destruction among the nations, among lands you have not known. Oh, sure, that's just a couple of weird guys have that thought, right? I don't know, there's more. Joel chapter 2, verse 30. I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance, as the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls. Whew, thank you for some good news finally. It's going to be terrible. There's going to be all this darkness and all, but there will be a place where people will be saved, where they'll be rescued, where they will be delivered, where they will be able to survive because the Lord calls. Amos 8, verse 8. Will not the land tremble for this and all who live in it mourn? whole land will rise like the Nile. It would be stirred up and then sink like the river of Egypt. I was reading this week about what would happen if the globe turned and literally land would go up and down. The plates that we talk about with the earthquakes and all would rise and fall and move all around. It's exactly like he's describing here. I don't think they could have understood all this. And yet Amos is saying the whole land will rise like the Nile. It will be stirred up and then sink like the river of Egypt. And that day, declares the sovereign Lord, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your religious festivals into mourning and all your singing into weeping. I will make all of you wear sackcloth and shave your heads. I will make that time like mourning for an only son and the end of it like a bitter day. It is said that people will get so distraught that they will start just dying. Think about the stress that people will start feeling if they were watching all these cataclysmic events taking place around them. And people will start having heart attacks and literally dying because of the stress. Zephaniah, the last books in the Bible, the great chapter 1, the great day of the Lord is near, near and coming quickly. The cry on the day of the Lord is bitter. The mighty warrior shouts his battle cry. That day will be a day of wrath, a day of distress and anguish, a day of trouble and ruin, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and blackness, a day of trumpet and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the corner towers. I will bring such distress on all people that they will grope about like those who are blind because they have sinned against the Lord. Their blood will be poured out like dust, and their entrails like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold will be able to save them on the day of the Lord's wrath. It doesn't matter how rich you are, you won't be able to protect yourself when that day comes. Everyone will be in the dark. Remember when the plagues were coming on Egypt and God was trying to set his people free from Egypt and the plagues were coming? Did Pharaoh experience the plagues? Just as much as everyone else. So when the frogs came up on the land, the frogs were in Pharaoh's house. When there was blood in the water on the land, there was blood in the water in Pharaoh's house. When the gnats and the flies, when there was plagues, when there was sickness, when boils, and when the hot like hail storm was coming down like fire, it was going right there in Pharaoh's house as well. And on the night that the angel of death passed over, the angel of death passed over every house, and wherever there was blood on the doorpost from the lamb, they were safe. But wherever there was not blood on a doorpost, the firstborn died, and the firstborn in Pharaoh's house died as well. It doesn't matter what wealth you have, what position you have, you will not be able to escape the day of the Lord without Christ. And Jesus goes on, he says, and at that time men will see, verse 26, and men will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And man will see it. Everyone will notice it. We'll all be able to realize it. Now, I don't know. Some have said, well, there's going to be this sign. In fact, theologians for a number of years believed there's going to be a big cross that's going to be sitting up there in the sky. We'll see the cross and we'll know Jesus is coming back. With the internet now, how can anyone miss it? I mean, if Jesus started floating down right there like he did when he ascended, because it says, in one of those who will see it, it says he's going to come back just like he left. And so if Jesus started floating down, do you think somebody would see it? Everyone would get out of their camera and they do this, right? And, oh, look here, he's up here, right up here. And you do your selfie. You know, let me see if I can get my picture in there with Jesus. You know, Jesus is coming down. Isn't that what we do? I mean, and wouldn't he go like everywhere? I mean, can anyone stop this information from getting out to anyone in the world? They've got this in the poorest places in the world. They've got cell phones. Have you watched it? Haiti, one of the most terrible places in poverty and all. But the people were there, and they're in the water, and they got their cell phones up. I mean, now, don't hold that against them. Obama gave away phones to people here too, right? Okay, that are on the street. Just the fact is that we are in a world that's way connected. So the whole world's going to know, and if God chooses to use technology to do that, I'm okay with that. But here's what I think. I think that it's actually going to be Jesus. Let me read that again. At that time, men will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And I think that the whole world is going to see Jesus coming down in power and glory. And if you didn't believe in Jesus, you may be running scared. In fact, Matthew, in talking about this, chapter 24, verse 29, says, immediately after the distress of those days. This is parallel passage to Mark 13, what I've been reading. It says, immediately after the distress of those days, that's the abomination that's put his statue right there in their worship. So we're halfway through the tribulation. Middle of the 7 years. The sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then all the peoples of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. They will mourn. Why would the world mourn when you see Jesus coming back? Because you're not ready for him to come. Because you don't believe he is real. Because you don't honor him. Because you have your own gods that you believe are more important than Jesus. And they will mourn. They'll also mourn, listen to this, Zechariah 13:8. In the whole land, declares the Lord, 2/3 will be struck down and perish, yet 1/3 will be left in it. You see, during this time that we thought it was a very peaceful time, and now when the Antichrist puts his statue there and he starts killing people, he's killing off Jews again, and he's killing off anyone else who has come to believe in Jesus Christ, and he's killing off anyone who opposes him in any kind of way, anybody who's not going to bow down to him, anyone who won't take the mark of the beast on their right hand or on their forehead will not be able to buy and sell. They're all going to be starting to die. There's going to be a lot of bad stuff, even though they've been thinking this was a time of peace. So I guess I have a real quick question. Do you have earthquake insurance? Why are you laughing? You live in Southern California, where there's earthquakes all the time, right? We live at San Andreas Fault. It runs like right almost down the base of this mountain, right? You shouldn't be laughing. If that thing goes, opens up and really splits, who knows? Maybe like he's talking about, this whole mountain just kind of falls overboard, right? Exactly. I knew it. Some of you are waiting for the beachfront property. But I got bad news for you. That's Arizona. Okay. California is under. Okay. Seriously, do any of you have earthquake insurance? You know, there's riders on your insurance that you might want to have. But here's the bad news is, earthquake insurance will do you no good in the tribulation. I had to pause as I was going through this, and I started asking a question. And my question was this: where is the church? Where is the church during the tribulation? Now, I probably should tell you that there's a sometimes almost hostile varying opinions about this. There's some pretty forceful camps. If you go on the internet, you can actually see some of these people and some of the argument and all, and it's pretty strong. So like you might have the Dallas Theological Seminary that people over here, and they're like, you know, okay, there's this dispensationalism and all, and everything happens before. And this is, by the way, where you want to be. And I'm only going to say, you'll see why I'm saying this in a moment. This is the dispensation that says that Jesus comes back, takes you to heaven before any of the bad stuff of the tribulation. Do you see why you would want to be in that group? I mean, forget your theology. Wouldn't it just be more fun to be over there than to go through the 7 years of really nasty, bad stuff in the middle of it, be a part of those 2/3 that gets to be killed, tortured, beat up, torn apart, who gets to experience all the darkness and the earthquake and the fires and the nasty stuff like that, and saying that you want to run, you want to hide, you want to pull out your hair, you want to put on sackcloth and ashes? I'm thinking that's not a time you really want to be alive. So, If you've got no real stake in this one, go ahead and pick that as your position. All right. And there's a lot of people, some really wonderful people, some tremendous theologians. One of my own friends, Dr. Walter Bramson, right? This is his position. And he says, it's incontrovertible. You're all going home before the tribulation. And if that happens, yes. Okay, however, there's another view. And that is that this is Jesus coming back right here. He's coming back in the middle of the tribulation after 3.5 years. And that's when he's going to sound the trumpet call. And that's when the Christians are going to be taken away. Because from there on out, he's going to be working on the 144,000 Jews. He's going to be trying to save them in other ways. And so he's going to get them out of there. They went through bad stuff, but a lot of them are basically just going to go home because they're going to get killed. And that's the second option. And here's the thing. If you didn't go here, okay, you probably ought to try to get out of here. Because the third option is over here. And that is right near the end, during the last bowl of wrath, when things have gotten really, really nasty, Jesus comes back for his bride and takes them to heaven. Now, here's why you don't want to be here. Because that means you have to go through almost all that whole 7 years. Well, so where is the church during the tribulation? I need to be fair to texts that are out there. For example, 1 Thessalonians 1:10. One of the key verses that those who would say, oh, you're gone before the tribulation, says this: and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath. And the belief is that, thank you, Jesus, we're not going to have to go through the coming wrath because you're going to rescue us. Although, I should be fair to the text, that also means that he could rescue you during the wrath, right? Or at the end of the wrath, which is the 6th, 7th bowl of wrath. By the way, if you're confused by any of these terms I'm using, read Revelation. I know you'll be more confused. But really, sometime just read Revelation and do what the first chapter says. Blessed are those who hear these words. Just hear the word of Revelation. Go through it all one time and just listen to it. And don't try to make a chart. There's too many of them out there already. Okay, don't try to diagram it all. Just listen. But here's a verse that's really important, Revelation 3:10. In Revelation 2 and Revelation 3, Jesus is speaking to the churches of Asia. He's speaking to his people. He will point out in those 7 different churches good and bad things in each one of them. Well, one, he only speaks bad, and one, he pretty much only speaks good. But anyways, if you take the 7 as a whole, he's going to speak good and bad things about the churches, and he's going to keep telling them, he who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of Jesus says to the churches. If you're willing to listen, you'll hear what God's trying to communicate. At chapter 3, verse 10, since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. If you then continue on through Revelation, so you go into Revelation 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, all the way to Revelation 19. Revelation 19 is the wedding of the bride of Christ. And who is the bride of Christ? The church throughout all the ages, followers of Jesus Christ, are the bride, beautifully adorned, Revelation 19 says. And what many will say is that if you look from Revelation 4 to Revelation 19, there's no talk about the church in between there. And that's one more evidence that the church is what we refer to as raptured, taken out before the tribulation occurs. In our text, Jesus says, at that time men will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory, and he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. 1 Peter 2:9 says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. He calls us out of the dark of our world and our sin, our mistakes, our shortcomings, the garbage of this world. He calls us out of that into life. Oh, by the way, the word there, chosen, is the same word in our text that Jesus says, the elect. The elect will be gathered. And if you look, I'll give you a couple other passages. Revelation 17, verse 14. They will wage war against the Lamb, but the Lamb will triumph over them because he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And with him will be his called, chosen, and faithful followers. He will be coming back. He'll be coming back for war. And with him will come his what? Called, chosen, and faithful followers. The word there is the same word again that Jesus used here for the elect. The elect. And if you look at every place where it's used in the New Testament, the elect are not the Jews, but the people who have accepted the Messiah, Jesus Christ, as the Anointed One. They've become the new chosen race, royal priesthood. Now, it can include Jews, right? And include anybody who wants to follow him. But it's all those who have now believed in the Messiah. And now it's interesting, and here's one of the reasons why there's some argument here as well. Because Jesus says he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Even though everywhere in the New Testament the word elect has been referring to Christians, here theologians would say, now this elect refers to the Jews that are still alive during the tribulation. And let's face it, God does something really special and wonderful for the Jews, doesn't he? He chose them centuries and centuries ago. He called them to be his covenant people. And because he made a covenant with them, he is also going to call them back to himself one more time. The Jews will get an option. And so Jesus actually talks about these, there being 12,000 in every tribe of Israel that will go out, makes up 144,000 if you ever heard that number, 144,000 that will go out as evangelists to all of Israel, to all the corners. And could it be that that's why Jesus is saying that the elect then will be gathered by the angels? Because, well, let's go on. I think the most important thing for us to get out of all this today is that Jesus will come again. It's a fact. There have been so many arguments, and sometimes people get so nasty about it. If you're not here, well, you can't be a follower of Jesus Christ. If you're not here, well, you know, thank God, because you're not in those really, you know, hypocritical people over there. If you're not here, you're the only people that are, you know, really thinking logically, because, you know, we couldn't find this one for sure or this one for positive. Yeah. You know what? What your view is isn't going to matter when Jesus returns. But Jesus is going to come again. And listen to some of the stuff that the Word says about that. John 14:3. Do you remember the context of John 14? Jesus is with his disciples. I said, our text right now in Mark 13 is Wednesday. Jesus is with his disciples, John 14, Thursday night. He's just done the Passover meal with them. He's told them one of them's going to betray him. He's told another one, Peter, you're going to deny me. He's washed their feet. And now, having washed their feet, he says, now you're supposed to go do the same thing. And then he says, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Jesus is coming again, and he personally is going to take us back to heaven. Acts 1:11. What's the context of Acts 1? 40 days after Jesus rose from the dead. 40 days he's been talking with about 500 different people, and especially the 11 apostles that are left, and he's talking to them about his return. He's talking to them about teachings. They've seen him risen. They've touched him. They've eaten with him. They've walked with him. They've had amazing time of seeing him for 40 days. And he takes the disciples up to a mountain and he leaves. Well, he ascends. Like, it's better than that. He's standing there with them. He's talking to them. He gives them this very important commission, and he says, okay, I'm leaving, guys. And he starts to ascend right before their eyes up into heaven. This is not Hollywood, kids. Okay, this is real life. God, who has risen from the dead, standing there right there with them. They've been hugging him, holding him, touching him, talking to him, and right in front of their eyes. Okay, this doesn't happen every day, does it? I know that, you know, what's his name? Scotty did it all the time with Star Trek. But this is not Star Trek, okay? This is God himself right in front of them, ascending up there, right there, going up into the clouds. And then this is what happens next. Men of Galilee. Who's that? It's a couple of angels show up on the scene. Start talking to the 11 disciples. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? Because if you were there that day and you saw Jesus ascending into heaven, don't you think you'd be kind of standing there watching it for a while? Oh, you know, it'd be one of those moments that it'd be really appropriate to say, oh my God. Have you ever noticed what people say when, you know, they win a big prize and they don't believe in God or something like that? You know, oh my God! No, that's not your God. But this would be an appropriate moment, like, oh my God! Oh, yeah, because it is God, and he's just going up in the skies and like, wow! Look at that! Kids, can anyone see him anymore? Get out the binoculars. They haven't created them yet. Oh well, keep staring. Oh my God! You know, what are you guys doing? We're trying to see if he's going to fall. How did he get up there? When's he coming back? Gentlemen. The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. Same way. We'll see him go up. And the whole world will see him come down. Now, if it's really dark and he is the light of the world, then if everything's black, I'm thinking it'll be pretty obvious when all of a sudden this light comes down in the midst of the dark. Thessalonians says it this way. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And after that, we are still alive, and our left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The Lord's going to come back, Jesus himself. And there will be a trumpet call, and the whole world will know it. And for those who have known Christ, who have died, their bodies get raised up. And for those who are still alive, they go through this amazing thing, what we call the rapture. They're raptured up. They're lifted up right out, just like Jesus went up, and they meet him there. And he says, encourage one another with these words. So how many of you have been just saying, isn't this a wonderful political season? Doesn't the Bible say give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of the Lord for you? So you all should be like, yes, Pastor Bill, yes, wonderful time, beautiful season. But look what Paul says. He says, even when the things get really bad, encourage one another with these words. Jesus will come back. And Jesus will take you out of this. And he'll welcome you up into heaven. And Revelation describes it that the bride, prepared, beautifully addressed, and adorned for the groom, will come down and we'll all gather together and celebrate. It'll be an incredible moment. And as bad as it is, as bad as it will get, Jesus is coming back to take us from that. But here's another fact too. Jesus didn't just leave. He left his spirit. So that when he left, in fact, he even said it, I've got to leave. Because if I don't leave, first off, if I don't leave, then it's just Virgil and me. And when we're just really close together. But Jesus says, look, if I leave, then everyone can have the presence of God with them through the Holy Spirit. And so you don't have to face the tough times, whatever times are like, alone. Because Jesus didn't just go to heaven to hide out. But he sent the spirit part of himself to come and dwell with us. To be with us. And so we hear Paul say, encourage one another with these words. And so if you follow up John 14, you'll see that in John 14, Jesus, as he actually talks about the Spirit coming, the Comforter, the Helper, the one who's going to come alongside of us and walk with us and carry us through the times. And then in John 15, he'll say that, look, you're my friends. And a friend is willing to die, and he's preparing them because in hours he's going to do that. And in John 16, he's getting them more ready for the Spirit and more ready for his death. In John 17, he prays for unity of us all. Who cares whether you're here or here or here? Jesus wants us to be one in him and to get ready. And he prays that high priestly prayer. And he prays that we would be one so that the world would know that God had sent him. Encourage one another with these words. Jesus is coming again. And what I want you to pray about is, how is that encouragement? Because for a world, if you were listening to all the nasty verses I read, when Jesus comes back, he comes back to judge. There's going to be horror in people's lives. Do you really want them? Do you want people that you know to experience that? Do you care about the people around you? Or would you want them? Do you love them enough? One guy said, how much do you have to hate a person to not tell them about Jesus? If you believe that Jesus is coming again, if you are confident that you've already got him in your life and you've got the hope of eternal life and you would be one of those raised up with him, if you believe that, how much do you have to hate the world to not take Jesus to them? When Colleen and Rob Myers come, and now notice I'm giving you an out. When Colleen and Rob Myers come, they're going to talk about the fact that God moved them to go out to the world, not to wait for the world to come to them. That's why they go to raves, to simply love on people, so that the world can see a different kind of love than what sometimes we as Christians get portrayed as. See, the sad thing is, the world sees us all, especially those of us with Baptist on the name, as Westside Baptist Church from Texas. That's what the world sees us as. Mean-spirited, unloving, unkind, judgmental, critical, harsh. It's the way the world sees us. How are we going to give them a different picture? By waiting for them to come here and see the truth, right? Because since they believe that about us, they'll surely want to come here, won't they? I apologize for the sarcasm. The only way they'll see it is if we love Jesus so much and we've felt and experienced that love of Jesus so much in our life that we go to them and show them God's love. Now, if you don't want to have conviction about doing that, stay away on the Sunday that Colleen and Rob come. By the way, it's not one of your days off. Encourage one another with these words. Jesus is coming again, and he's looking forward to welcoming you. Lord Jesus, Revelation ends with, "Come quickly, Lord Jesus." Maranatha, come quickly, Lord Jesus. And I confess there's a part of me that still doesn't quite pray that prayer, "Come quickly." Because I'm still concerned about my friends and people I know who don't know you, Jesus. And frankly, I don't want you to come back until they come to believe and know you. And I thank you, God, that it does encourage us to know that you will return, that you will have victory over the darkness and the worst of all darkness in the world. You will have victory, that you've defeated Satan already and you're going to completely defeat him. It does encourage me, God. But there's a part of me that still weeps that those who don't know how much you love them. And I pray that you would help us to love them like you loved us. Just with your head bowed and your eyes closed, if you're not ready for Jesus to come back because you haven't believed in him, but you want to, and you want to take that moment today, just say, "Jesus, I want to commit my life to following you." I want to invite you, just raise your hand as a statement to him. If you have people that you know, this is not being judgmental, folks. This is about being honest about the truth. If you have people that you know who do not know the love of Jesus Christ, and you'll make a commitment to do something to show them that love this week, not 39 years from now, this week, will you raise your hand? So God, Spirit of God, anoint us to follow through and to show your love. And Lord, oh, help us to recognize the divine appointment that you're setting aside for somebody that we can love for you. And may they hear and see you in a way they've not seen you before. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.